But we're continuing our thought from Sunday. So we looked at holy living on Sunday. That was really part one. Tonight is part two, and we're going to continue right on in 1 Peter. But let me ask you a question. Have you ever thought that you had things together, but you really didn't? Now, guys, let me talk to you for a minute. This is like every day for us. Like, we're like, we think we have it together, and we really do not. Like, we just thought we had the kids ready. We thought she was going to say yes, and we thought I got the job promotion, and we thought that I had, you know, I changed the oil ride, and I got all the things fixed, and we didn't. And so this is us every day. But I remember years ago, I was a youth pastor at another church down below, and I was putting on a winter camp, and it was probably the single most event that I have ever worked the most in my life on a project. We had a couple hundred people going, and we went up to I was so proud. I found the campsite at the very top of the Big Bear Mountain. Like, it was like the camp and then Jesus. Like, that was as high as we were. And it was thousands of feet in the air. And we were going to go during January, tons of snow. We were going to go snowboarding. I had everything mapped, like every game, every meal, every speaker. I had it all planned out. I was so pumped for this winter camp to take place. And so I had scouted it a couple of months before. We made sure everything was lined up. And so we had several buses ready to go, all the kids, students loaded up and put all their luggage, and we were just ready. I was so pumped for this winter camp. So we get up there, and they had a pretty high, heavy snowfall the week before. But, you know, it's snow, it's winter camp. We're California kids, we want the snow. We want as much snow as possible. But the problem was the snow actually wreaked havoc up in the heavens, you know, a Big Bear in the top. And so all of a sudden our several buses started to slip off of the road. And all of a sudden the drivers were like, we're not going any further. And I'm like, well, the camp is right there. You've got to get us into camp. No, did you see? We're like roller skating right now on the ice, like as a bus, and that is not a good thing. And so I'm like, well, what do you want us to do? You're going to need to get all the kids off, unload the luggage, and then you just walk to camp. That's like a quarter, a half mile away, and probably if I'm being like maybe, if I'm dramatic, that was like a 6 mile hike, you know, up the snow, like you did when you were little, right? When you tell your grandkids that you'd walk up the snow both ways. But we had to get off of the bus, get all our luggage, which, you know, looking back was hilarious, as these little junior high girls are with their huge rolling backpacks or luggage trying to go through the snow. And the bus driver's like, we are not going any further. And so all of a sudden I'm like, okay, this is not a good sign. I think I have it together, but all right, let's see what's going to happen. And so we get all of our luggage there, and we get finally to the campsite. And the camp directors, there was two of them, one said, hey, my other camp director, they're having a nervous breakdown because they saw the snow and saw you guys coming, and they can't handle this, so they're unavailable this weekend. I'm like, well, they're strike two, okay? And then they said, and some of the cabins, actually, some of the seals of the doors, the metal and the frames, they're sealed shut. So some of our cabins are unavailable. And so your boys are going to have to sleep somewhere else. I'm like, well, where are they going to sleep? I don't know. I'm like, well, you're the camp director. Like, what is going on? And so then all of a sudden we find out that the kitchen didn't plan or buy enough food for the camp. And so we were going to be there Friday night through Sunday morning. And so they said, I think we have enough food for you guys tonight and maybe for breakfast tomorrow. I'm like, well, what about the rest of the weekend? I don't know. I'm like, that is your favorite word right now. I don't know. Like, what are you doing? And I remember, I mean, thousands of dollars has been in this moment, hundreds of hours, lots of fundraising. Like, this was, I mean, several strikes now. So the toilets froze. There's no water, there's no showers. I actually, and this is kind of gross, but it's a Wednesday crowd, I could say this. I don't know what the ladies did for the restroom, but the guys just went in the bushes. Like, it was just that kind of weekend. And I'm thinking, like, where in the world? And then people looking at me, you're like, why did you bring us up here? Like, what is wrong with you? And I thought this was gonna be a great time. And so now we get all of our leaders, and we have some people there, and we have some, you know, I was in my 20s at the time, and so we have some, you know, quote unquote, adults in the room now to help kind of us navigate this situation. And they're like, we are going to make it through the night. By the way, there was no heat in the cabins because everything was frozen, and I mean it was really wild. So we get into this kitchen. We have like just some rudimentary food and something. I think we ate crackers or something. I don't remember what the food was, but it was very basic. And we have a little Bible study, and then we're like, "All right, well, go to sleep." Well, we're gonna go to sleep. You're gonna go to sleep right here in the kitchen. Like, boys, that's where you're gonna sleep. And maybe you're gonna sleep over there next to that room, and you're gonna sleep in this cafeteria. And we just spread everything out. And I remember thinking the next morning, I had my boss, the pastor, call, like, "What is going on up there?" Like, that's never a good call to receive when you're taking a couple hundred students up to Big Bear Mountain. And I'm like, "We have it under control." You know, that was, I think it's okay for Christians to lie sometimes. I'm not sure, but I did. And we've got it under control. We didn't have it under control because the next morning they were like, "You will come down and you are not keeping our kids up there any longer." And so I'm like, "Well, the buses can't drive up here." "I don't care. You walk to the buses." And so the girls had to, and the guys walked back through the snow the next morning, and we went home and we survived one night up on the heavens of Big Bear. And I thought about that a lot because I'm like, in your best laid plans, in the moments where you think that I have everything under control, all of a sudden now you have this moment where you're like, "I have nothing under control." And that's really kind of how it feels like with life sometimes. You get married and you're ready. You've got it all under control. I did my premarital counseling. I've got my all my date nights planned. I've got everything ready to go. We're gonna go. And then all of a sudden, the honeymoon's over. Month comes, 2 months, 6 months, and you're like, "I don't know what I'm doing." You go to a job and you're like, "I've got this job. I'm ready. This is what I went to school for. This is what I've been hoping for. I've got it." First day comes, first assignment, and you're like, "I am not prepared for this." Oh my goodness, a baby comes. We baby-proof the house. We got the everything ready. We have the baby bed. I'm ready. And all of a sudden now you're like, "Oh wow, they're here and I have no idea what to do." All of a sudden the world comes. Culture hits. And you're with your Bible at work, or you're talking about your faith in a public setting, and then all of a sudden you're like, "I am following Jesus." And then people are like, "Why do you follow them?" And you're like, "I don't know what I should say." Well, Peter talks about this idea of how to continue on in holy living, what to do when you and I aren't really sure about what to do. And so Peter goes on in verse number 17. I want to read these verses to you as we move on in our series together. And be reminded that 1 Peter is a letter. It's a letter written from Peter to Christians. By the way, do you remember receiving letters in school? Those were like fun days. Now kids, they like text or TikTok people. I don't even know. The older teenagers, they send snaps or something. I don't know what they do now. But all of a sudden now we have this impersonal kind of, you know, form of communication with people. But back in these biblical times, you got a letter from Peter, from an apostle. You got letter from Paul. You got letters from these people who wrote to you, and you would take that and you would read every single word. And 1 Peter was a letter to the Christians that they were so excited to receive. So verse number 17, here's what Peter writes. He says in verse number 17 of 1 Peter chapter 1, "If you appeal to the Father who judges impartially according to each one's work, you are to conduct yourselves in reverence during your time living as strangers." You remember that word strangers? We looked at that earlier in the passage of being exiles, that we are just strangers in this land. He goes on to say in verse number 18, "For you know that you were redeemed from your empty way of life, inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Jesus Christ, like that of an unblemished and spotless lamb. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but wasn't revealed in these last times for you. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God." I'm going to share with you tonight, in our few moments together, just three unquestionable keys for holy living. How can we continue on in this holy path? I actually heard a pastor recently say that sin is rebellion against God. So we know what God's called us to do, and we sin. When we do something against it, we are rebelling against God. But holiness is actually rebellion against the world. Because the world tells us, you don't need to follow God. You don't need to live a pure life. You don't need to be, Jesus-y, or you don't need to have your faith out in the open. And holiness says, no, I reject the world because I want to follow God. Because all of us are rebels at some point. And if you don't think you're a rebel, well, then how fast do you drive? Like, we break some rules all the time. As I'm getting older, I'm like, why does that rule exist? Why do they want me to do that in line? I was at DMV recently with my oldest daughter, and it's like, why do they do those things? There is no earthly reason of why they have that, because all of us have some rebel at our hearts. And so sin says, I'm going to rebel against God. I'm not going to do what he's called me to do. I'm going to openly sin. But holiness is saying, hey, I reject the world's way because that is not the right way. That's the way that leads to death and destruction. So here's a few thoughts I'm going to share with you as we think about this idea of holy living, some keys. You see, in verse number 17, we find this. It says, if you appeal to the Father who judges impartially according to each one's work, you are to conduct yourselves in reverence during your time living as strangers. You see, the first thought I want to share with you tonight is a holiness or holy living. It starts with and it continues on with a healthy fear of God. The idea here is that you and I would be respectful of who God is and what he's done for us. Now, before we talk about how to fear God, let's talk about how we don't fear God. We don't fear God when we're careless with our descriptions of him. I don't know if you've said this before, if you've heard people say it, but let me tell you, calling God the big guy or the man upstairs is not a sign of reverence toward God. Calling God like the big one in the sky, the one who kind of, the old man on the throne, or however careless phrases we use, is not bringing reverence to our God. Even saying things like, I swear to God, or, oh my God, those are not bringing reverence to the name of the Father. That's how we don't fear God. Now, we have some younger people in here, and so you're not going to understand what I'm going to say for the next few moments, and so bear with me, but there used to be these things that you would go to. We didn't have the video game systems like we have today, so you'd have to go to a room full of these old boxy games called arcade systems, and it was this room that you had to go in, and you actually had to go around people to play a video game, and it wasn't wireless controllers. It wasn't even nice graphics. It was like boxes that you're excited. You played Pong, and you're like, show a kid Pong today, and they're going to be like, what are you doing? How old are you? Speaking of games, years ago, we were watching, I don't know if you remember this, but there was a game show in the 80s called Double Dare, and it was like kind of a game where they had goop and stuff, and you had to do obstacle courses, and they remade that show maybe 10 years ago or so, and our youngest daughter, she's watching the show with us, and they did the old show in like the 80s, early 90s, and she's looking at it, and she's like looking at me and looking at Amy, and then she's watching the screen, and she's like, Dad, are those people dead? I'm like, no, those people are me. Like, that's my age. And I, like kids these days, they don't understand what we went with. But if you remember those games, and if you remember the arcade going, and you had a stack of quarters that you put on there, and you're going to play your favorite game. And if you remember, if you weren't playing the game, there would be some screens that kind of revolve on the screen that you would see. One of the screens was a title screen and maybe a demo. But there was one screen in particular that you always wanted to take notice of, and that was the leaderboard. Because you wanted your name on the leaderboard. It wasn't your name. It was like three letters. It was initials or, sometimes people would try to put crass things on there. But it was three initials. But here's what I want to share with you. Often fearing God is keeping his name at the top of the leaderboard. Here's the problem sometimes. We allow life to come in, and all of a sudden our spouse is on the top of the leaderboard. We have kids coming, and we want to love them and support them, but our kids shoot to the top of the leaderboard. Sometimes our boss shoots to the top of the leaderboard because we want that promotion, and we want what's next in our career. But here's the point. A healthy fear of God always keeps the name of the Father at the top of the leaderboard, where it says, hey, I don't care what else is going on. I don't care if I'm going to lose at this game of life that everyone is putting me into this rat race and in this corporate push for the next promotion. I want the Father to be at the top of the leaderboard because I am fearing and respecting the Father. Here's how Solomon writes it in Ecclesiastes chapter number 8. And Ecclesiastes is a book I don't recommend if you're trying to, encourage yourself. It's kind of a discouraging book and a depressing book in the beginning. It's not a book that you're like, I just love the Bible more, because this is a book that's like, man, I don't even like life. Solomon's like, everything is meaningless. Welcome to Scriptures. And Solomon's like, I've lived this whole life and it is all vanity. It's all meaningless. But he writes this insightful thought in Ecclesiastes chapter number 8, where he says this in verse number 10. In such circumstances, I saw the wicked buried. They came and went from the holy place, and they were praised in the city where they did those things. This too is futile or vanity or meaningless. Now, because the sentence against an evil act is not carried out quickly, the heart of the people is filled with a desire to commit evil. Solomon, are you living in 2023? Like, this is our time right now. Look what he says in verse number 12. Although a sinner does evil 100 times and prolongs his life, I also know that it will go well with God-fearing people, for they are reverent before him. However, it will not go well with the wicked, and they will not lengthen their days like a shadow, for they are not reverent before God. So here's what Solomon's saying. He's saying, hey, I know that it seems like people are doing whatever they want. They're living however they want. I mean, they're not even sniffing holiness. Like, they're just like so far away. They're doing their own thing. Evil in their eyes. We talked about this past Sunday. They're doing that which is right in their own eyes, and it doesn't seem as if anything is bothering them or affecting them. But he says, I've seen the end. Fear of God is important, and they are not walking reverently. So you continue to walk in this path where you are fearing the Lord. You see, holy living begins with this healthy fear of God. We say, God, we are respecting you. We're keeping you at the top of the leaderboard. But the second thing I want to share with you is this. We find this in verses number 18 and 19. Not only do we need to have a healthy fear of God, but we need to have a desperate understanding of our need. A desperate understanding of our need. Now, this is a hard message for Americans to hear because we don't feel like we have a lot of need. Did you know that if you have a net worth of $93,000, then you are in the top 10% of the richest people in the world? In fact, if you have just $4,000, you are in the top 50% of the richest people in the world. When you explain need to Americans, we don't really understand. In fact, we just prayed over the team that's going to Malawi. I didn't really understand need until I was there. We visited a school, and the headmaster was so excited about her facilities, and they were so nice, and she was so grateful for all that she had in the school, and she kept describing these restroom facilities, and she kept going on about how nice they were and how amazing they were, and I'm thinking, like, man, these might be the nicest restrooms in Malawi the way she's talking about it. And so then a couple of the pastors were like, well, can we go see them? And in fact, can we use them? We need to go to the restroom. We've been out for a while. And she's like, oh, yes. And so she walked us to the restrooms, and there was individual stalls with doors on them. And so we go into the stall and look at the restroom, and it was a hole in the ground. Now, the difference between it and maybe a regular hole was it actually had a small concrete little round thing with a barb handle on it that you open up the handle to cover the hole and to close it and open it, but it was still a hole in the ground. And I remember thinking, like, oh, this was the nice restroom she was talking about. This was the, you know, covered facilities that they have. And I remember thinking, like, man, like, this compared to anything we have on this side, they have need. We don't even fully understand need. Now, I'm not talking just about physical need, because the Bible is a spiritual book. We need to understand our spiritual need. So let me read to you verses number 18 and 19, and let's talk about our spiritual need for just a moment. We find this in verse number 18 where Peter says this, "For you know that you were redeemed." We'll talk about that word in a moment. "Redeemed from your empty way of life." And by the way, life without Jesus is empty. Empty way of life inherited from your ancestors, not with gold or silver, but with the precious blood of Christ. Now, let's talk about that word redeemed for just a moment. That word redeemed means to pay a ransom, to pay a ransom. In fact, in Ephesians chapter number 2, it says in verse number 1, "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins." And so we're not going to read the rest of the passage, but Paul in Ephesians and Peter in 1 Peter basically are saying the same thing, that says, hey, you have a tremendous debt. We read in Romans that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We read that there is none righteous, no, not one. We read that, hey, for the wages of sin is death. but the gift of God is eternal life. And what we need to understand is there's a tremendous spiritual need, but God redeemed us. So here's what that means. That means he paid a ransom for you. It means that you were dead in your trespasses and sins, that you didn't have any sort of hope. You were living a life that was empty, and Jesus came along. He paid your ransom, like we read in Colossians, which was to redeem you. It's a beautiful story. It's a beautiful picture, because you and I have this hope now because of Jesus paying for your sins and for mine. But we need to have a desperate understanding of our need. We need to understand that, hey, we're not just merely good, or we're not close to being like God. Like, no, the gap between us and God is so great. In fact, Isaiah reminds us, he says, hey, even your righteousness, the best days that you live, the greatest things about you, the things that you want all your social media profiles to know that you are, all of those things are like filthy rags compared to Jesus' sacrifice. Now, that's not to diminish you as a person. That's not to say that you don't bring value or God hasn't gifted you, but that is to say that if we try to put all of our chips on the table and say, God, look at all the things I've done, all God has to say is, well, look at all the things that I've done. Look at all the sin that you bring. Look at all the things that you have in your life that you need to move away from. We are living this empty life apart from Jesus. We must have a desperate understanding of our need. But the last thing I want to share with you is found in verses 20 and 21. And if we're going to have this holy life, we need to have, not only do we need to know that we have this desperate need, not only do we need to understand that we have to have a fear of God, but we also need to have an unwavering faith and hope. I love what Peter writes in verse number 21. He says, through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Have you ever thought about what you and I put our faith and hope in? Often, many of us might put our faith and hope in a stock market. And we might put our faith in and say, man, look at our accounts. Look at our portfolio. That's where our hope is. Some of us put faith and hope in lottery tickets. I had someone recently tell me that they had purchased a lottery ticket, I think, for like 6 or 7 years in a row, and they had not won a thing. But the idea of a lottery player or a gambler at maybe Vegas or another place is, well, it's going to be the next one. It's going to be the next ticket. It's going to be the next pull. It's going to be the next bet. But it never, ever happens. We put our faith and hope in fortune cookies. Which, by the way, I recently got a fortune cookie with two fortunes in it. I don't even know what this means. I opened up this fortune cookie and, like, not one, but two fortunes. And I read them. I'm like, yeah, they're pretty good. But do they cancel each other out because I got two? I'm not sure. Like, should I pick one? Should I burn one? I don't know fortune cookie, you know. I don't know all the ideas and the idiosyncrasies of that, but many times we'll put our faith and hope in a fortune cookie. By the way, some of us, even Christians, will put our faith and hope in a horoscope, in a palm reader, in a fortune teller. We'll put our faith and hope in. And I've had people ask me, well, what's your sign? I'm like, what sign? Well, where were you born? What's your sign? And I'm like, the cross? Like, I don't know. Like, what's the sign for Jesus? That's the one I want to be. Well, are you a Leo or a Sagittarius? I don't know. I'm just team Jesus. Like, that's all I know. But Christians, yeah. I've even heard Christians, well, I read it every day. I read my horoscope every day because it's going to give me kind of a path. I'm like, well, do you read God's word every day? Like, that's more important. Like, and then the problem sometimes is, even as Christians, we put our faith and hope in other things. In fact, we read about this in the Old Testament. King Saul was, Samuel the prophet had died, and King Saul had no one to talk to, and so he actually went to a medium. This lady who conjured up the spirits, and he wanted to find an answer for what he was supposed to do. But here's the interesting thing. Saul, who was the king of Israel, do you know who he used the medium to conjure up the spirit of? Samuel. Now, here's why it's important for us, because Christians will often use unchristian things to try to go back to spiritual things. Now, here's how this plays out for us. Well, if I just read Oprah's book on spirituality, it's her book club winner, I can be more spiritual. And what we're doing is we're going through maybe even, presence or demonic spirits or things that God would not want us to try to reach God. And we don't need to do that because we have the Holy Spirit, one. We have God's word, two. And you don't need to do fortunes or palms or tellers. You don't need to read a horoscope. You don't need to have a sign. You have a sign from God, and that's all you need. But too often we have this mentality where, well, you know, what does this so-and-so say? Well, what does this say for my life today? And we're using demonic spirits to get to the people or the Spirit of God, and we don't even need that. You see, holy living continues on with unwavering faith and hope. We need to be careful with the influences we allow in our hearts and our life. Sometimes we'll even use objects, and we'll use things in our house, or we'll use maybe even symbols or idols or statues or rocks or anything like that to kind of have a spiritual influence in our life. And we find that we don't need faith and hope in those things. Those don't bring any sort of salvation or settling to our heart. All we need is the Holy Spirit through God's word to have that faith and hope. I want to read one last passage to you, and it's in Romans chapter number 5. This is Paul writing, and we're going to close with this. He says, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have also obtained access through him by faith into this grace which we stand, and we boast in the hope, there's that word again, of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our afflictions, because we know that affliction produces endurance, and endurance produces proven character, and proven character produces hope. And verse number 5 says, this hope will not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Now, if you've noticed in these first few weeks of this First Peter series, there's a word that you've heard over and over and over again, and that's the word hope. But I need you to know, as we close our time together, the biblical word hope is much different than our word hope today. You see, our word hope today, we tend to think something like, it's an open possibility in the future. Like, I hope she says yes. I hope I pass this test. I hope I get this job. I hope I do this right. It's this open possibility that may happen in the future. And if we're not careful, we might think of it's the same thing in scriptures. Well, if we're to hope in Jesus, well, I hope Jesus comes through. I hope that I have eternal life. I hope that there's a heaven. But that's not the biblical word of hope. You see, the word hope that we read in scriptures, the word hope that God uses has his definition that we read in 1 Peter and Romans and others is this. Hope is not an open possibility in the future. Hope is a guaranteed outcome. So when you read hope, we have the hope of eternal life. We have the hope of the Holy Spirit. We have the hope of God's word. We have the hope of victory. It's not an open possibility like, I hope Jesus comes through. No. That's not that hope. The hope that we believe in, the hope that we read of in Scripture, it is a guaranteed outcome. Now, how does that change our view? If we know that God has given us the victory, it is guaranteed, then we can live freely. We don't have to try to use the horoscopes or the spirituality books or try to find and navigate our way, because we know that God has already given us the victory. You see, the hope that you believe in and the hope that we read in scriptures are often different. I don't just try to like, Lord, I hope you're real. It's like, we already know that he is real. Well, Jesus, I hope that you're preparing a place for us like you say in John 14. Nope, we already know that's a guaranteed outcome. Well, I hope that Jesus is able to get me through this situation and through this season. Nope, we already know that it may not be pretty. It may not be easy, but Jesus is going to get you through. It is a guaranteed outcome. So the hope that you have is not, I wish, I think, maybe, possibly. Nope. We can stand assured that the living hope we believe in, the living hope we read in 1 Peter, it is guaranteed. Now let me ask you this question. How many things in life are guaranteed? We have some young people in the room. If you have someone that says, I guarantee you this, they're lying. It's not real. Listen to people who have fallen for those guaranteed traps. I guarantee you I'll get you a good deal in a car. It's probably lying. I guarantee I'll get you in this school. Don't listen. Guarantees in our life are few and far between. Most often we overpromise, we underdeliver, and we have a hope that maybe we just get something out of it one day. But that is not the same with the Lord. He says, "Hey, I'm saying hope, but I want you to know it's guaranteed. The outcome is assured. The victory is sealed. You are mine, and I am yours." And so as a Christian, we say, "All right, God, I'm going to rebel against the world for you. I'm going to live a holy life. I'm going to be unwavering in the faith and hope that I'm putting in you, because I know greater are you that is in me than you that he that is in the world, and you have given us victory." And so let me encourage you with this. I don't know what battles you're facing. I don't even know how you're trying to fight those battles. Maybe you do know your sign, or you are looking into some spirituality, or you're trying to maybe what you feel are good things to try to get to the best thing, and you're trying to navigate this, and I totally understand. But let me tell you, those are just finite. Those don't last. We have a hope that's not a possibility, that we think Jesus will come. We know he will. He's guaranteed it with his blood on the cross, the precious blood of Jesus. And that is how we can say for sure, hey, when our time on this earth is done, we'll be with him in heaven. And that is the living hope that we rest on. And we already know it is guaranteed. And we know that he has already given us the victory. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me as we wrap up our time together? And I want to give you a moment just to respond. If you're watching with us online, we're so grateful that you're with us, and maybe you're watching from an office or a commute or your home or wherever you are. And let me ask you two questions. One is for those who've already put their faith and hope in Jesus, and one is for those who have yet to do that. If you have already put your faith and hope in Jesus, let me ask you this question. You have put your faith and your eternity in his hands, but are you putting your daily life in his hands? Is there something right now that you're going to a fortune teller, a medium, a palm reader, a horoscope, or if you're going somewhere other than Jesus, is that something you need to pull back? Say, "God, I don't need to do that anymore. I'm going to go straight to the source through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the gift of God's word. That is where I'm putting my unwavering faith and hope in." And maybe if that's you, and this is no judgment or condemnation, but this is a call for us to come back and say, "All right, God, I want what's best for my life, and I will put that into your hands." Now, perhaps you're sitting here, and maybe you're watching online, and you've never put your faith and hope in Jesus for the very first time. There's never been a moment in your life where you said, "God, I have definitely done some wrong things. There's definitely some things in my past, in my closet, there's some skeletons there that, man, I can't believe that those are in my past." But let me tell you, there's a God who saves. And he paid for your sin with his blood, his precious blood. You have a great need, but Jesus can meet that need. And so there's no one looking around. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed as we are wrapping up our time together. If you've never said yes to God, if you've never put your faith and hope in him, here's how we do it here at the Highlands. We won't embarrass you. We won't ask you to stand or come forward. I just want you to simply raise your hand, and I will agree with you, and I'll lead you into a short, simple prayer. My prayer doesn't save you, but your heart and praying out to God, he'll come in and save you. He'll hear you. And so with no one looking around, is there anybody in this room that would say, "Pastor Jeremy, I've never said yes to God. I never put my faith and hope in him, but I want to today." If that's you, would you just do me the absolute honor of just simply raising your hand? I see you. I see you. I agree with you. I agree with you. What a great decision that you're making. Appreciate your honesty as well. I see you too. I agree with you. If you're watching online, this is for you as well. I see you all the way in the back. What a great decision that you're making. It takes a measure of boldness to lift a hand and say, "Hey, that's me." We honor you. We agree with you. We'll pray with you in a moment. If you're watching with us online, you can join us as well, because the beauty of our God is that he is everywhere. And so for those that raise your hand in this room and for those that are watching online, would you pray something along these lines? Dear God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for me. I know that I've done wrong. I know that I'm a sinner. Would you forgive me? Would you come into my life and clean me from the inside out and help me to walk in your ways? I'm putting my faith and hope in you. Thank you for loving me. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.